Maxine Flyways, the Westport Library Director, and it's my pleasure to welcome you to the 12th Malloy Lecture in the Arts. And yes, there is a person behind that name. Susan Malloy is with us this evening, and I would like to ask her to stand up and take a well-deserved bow. Generosity and commitment to the Westport Library, thousands and thousands of people have heard conversations just like this evening, and we are so, so grateful. And what an honor it is to assemble hundreds of you this evening to hear Clive Davis, truly one of the titans of the music world. I also want to thank Westporter Mel Katz, because it was his suggestion. Mel and Clive Davis were friends at Harvard Law School, and have stayed close ever since. So thank you, Mel, for making tonight possible. Recently, a reporter was quoted saying, "We have followed Davis around for much of the past month, trying to keep up with him. He's fun to be around. Something is always happening. New young composers want to meet with him. Senior citizen superstars need his ear. He is always unruffled and has time for everyone. And his necktie and handkerchief always match." We are so grateful that he has time to be here in Westport. So about tonight, we will eavesdrop on a conversation between Clive Davis and his biographer, Anthony DeCurtis of Rolling Stone magazine. Then it's our turn to ask a few questions. There are microphones in the aisles. With so many people here, please make sure you have a question ready so that we can get as many people as possible. Following the Q&A, Mr. Davis will be signing his book, The Soundtrack of My Life, which is for sale on the way out if you haven't already purchased it. We take cash, checks, and credit cards. This is the one night your library card won't be of much use. The Westport Library has a long history of serving its stellar community, and it's only through your generosity that we hit the highest levels and meet your expectations. I thank all of you for sharing your ideas, your contributions, and your time. Together, we will bring the best public library anywhere to the community and beyond its borders. So take a moment to silence your ringers, unwrap those candies, and it's on with the show.
I never pictured myself in the music business. I was not a music junkie. I was not a collector. It was not permeating my blood. I just knew that the first time I saw Janis Joplin, I got a special feeling, and it changed the rest of my life. I had no clue that music would become my passion.
Probably the most knowledgeable man the record business has ever known.
His remarkable five-decade career has established him as one of the most powerful forces in the history of the music business.
Ladies and gentlemen, the record executive of the year is Mr. Clive Davis.
My hero.
Clive Davis. Clive Davis,
live again. I love you.
Mike. Involvement with music began at Columbia Records.
Clive Davis, who became administrative vice president at Columbia in 1965 and was made president 2 years later, is now at the head of Arista Records.
One of the great successes, but we've broken a dozen artists at Arista Records in a year and a half.
Clive Davis has joined forces with L.A. Reid and Babyface Headman to form LaFace Records.
They knew blue collar R&B. I felt that they, in the same way that you signed artists, that they were unique. Then Puffy came along, and I gave him the opportunity. Dark Bad Boy was a joint venture. The first artist I ever signed was Janis Joplin.
I signed Bruce Springsteen with John Hammond in 1972.
I went in and I sat down and played the songs, and he was very gracious to a very nervous kid from New Jersey.
Leisure is a self-contained
take orders.
And I think he knew that and saw that, and he really just let me find it.
And over the years, he's discovered great artists such as Blood, Sweat, Tears, Chicago, Aerosmith, Earth, Wind, and Fire, Billy Joel, Barry Manilow, Patti Smith, Jennifer Hudson, and Whitney Houston.
Girl is 19 years old, elegant, got an incredible range of talent, but guts and soul.
And that's what I felt the other night when you took me to see Whitney Houston.
You wait for a voice like that for a lifetime.
Where do old artists go?
They have had great, great fortune. Being currently associated with Aretha Franklin, Dionne Warwick, artist.
You turned Dionne Warwick's whole career around.
I love the challenge of extending careers.
The result? An album that sold over 25 million copies worldwide and won Santana 8 Grammys, including one for Clive Davis.
We had this incredible comeback with Rod Stewart. You will do between 150,000 and 200,000 next week. What? Avery Wilson, he's 18 years old, and he's the one that's going to be singing for you today. And I'm helping him navigate through the three labels, Epic, Columbia, and RCA. Today he's auditioning for RCA.
I've been so many places in my life and time.
This young man really knocked me out. To me, was almost a throwback to my auditions of Alicia and Whitney.
He taught me precious secrets of a true love we hold in our hands.
The magic and the excitement and the thrill of discovery without notice is as palpable today as ever.
Always wanted to inspire people to be greater, and he inspired me to want to be greater.
You're going to love the evening. You're going to see new artists. You're going to see people that you don't expect. I'm Clive Davis.
Hi, nice to meet you.
But every song is like gold teeth, gray goose tripping in the bathroom, blood stains, ball gowns, trash in the hotel room.
He's the icon who we all, you know, we're about to see. He kept reminding us not to give up, right? And he kept leaving and coming back greater. And he's been a great inspiration to a lot of us. He's made so many great artists and the whole industry is a fans of Clive Davis.
Let me live that fantasy.
I guess you get tested and no one's life goes up, up, up.
It was a bombshell when CBS fired Clive.
I did become a sacrificial lamb. There was someone in the company.
BMG tried to force Davis out of Arista Records and replace him with a younger executive.
Fact of the matter is that you were too old, right? Wrong.
I tried to retire twice, right? And said all the time, but he was gone, he kept coming back.
Contact this. Right. Like, what are those anymore?
Anybody can download the client, and instantly they have access to all the world's music at their fingertips.
Janis Joplin's death has become part of rock mythology.
Sadly, I've had to witness some great artists lose their lives.
Singer Whitney Houston is dead.
All I can say is that I loved her very much. It was a tough period, but the hits keep coming. In business terms, you've got to have hits, you've got to show what have you done lately. So I never take anything for granted. business, you have to keep proving yourself. They don't play your record because you discover shopping.
You didn't necessarily grow up as an avid music fan. You weren't an obsessive music collector. Why don't you talk a little bit about, you know, how you did grow up and what your musical interests were at the beginning?
Okay, I mean, because part of this involves the subject of luck, fate, if you will. I have no clue, as I said in this trailer, actually, for a feature documentary on the that music would become my passion. No clue whatsoever. And when I was a kid, growing up in Brooklyn, I really had normal listening habits. There was a program at that time called Make Believe Ballroom, and that's when we heard the new songs of the day from Martin Block, and it was the era of Sinatra and Bing Crosby and Perry Como and Dinah Shore and Kay Starr. And so, I was a normal listener. I didn't collect records, but I was aware, clearly, of the hit songs of the day and the hit artists of the day. And I think I was really most impressed with theater, Broadway musical theater, because in that era, so many of the songs is there a technical problem? So, can you hear me now?
Yes.
In those days, the songs that came from Oklahoma were Carousel, or ultimately My Fair Lady, South Pacific Sound of Music, really were the songs of the era. It was such a golden period, that and jazz, clearly were the great contributions, I think, of American music to the world.
Well, you know, you ended up going as your colleague who was here, who went to Harvard Law School. You came out, you were looking for jobs in law in New York, and you ended up being offered a position at Columbia Records. And one of the people, I think, you know, who served as something of a mentor to you was a man named Goddard Lieberson, who's a very important figure in music history. But Goddard, there came to be a kind of crossroads in your development under Goddard, and he offered you one job that maybe didn't suit you exactly well, and then offered you another one that maybe fit you a little better. I wonder if you could describe that.
Love it. Okay, let me just say as well, the importance of education. I lost my parents, which I certainly write about in the book, when I was a teenager, and I had no money. And the only way that you rise above the station, even today or certainly when I was growing up, was through education. And by getting scholarships to NYU, by getting scholarships to Harvard, coming from a religious background. I'm not religious, but I was certainly, my religion is Jewish, and the ethnic nature of the Jewish culture, your parents might have been tailors or grocers or butchers, but you had to have a profession. And so because I didn't like the sight of blood, I would never be a doctor. And so I became a lawyer. And that was it. It wasn't even I had any choice. I didn't have any scientific or electronic background. And so here I was, I went to Harvard, graduated, got to a firm where, for those of you who know the name Judge Samuel Rosenman, he was the lawyer for Franklin Roosevelt and Harry Truman. They had a very good firm, very first-class firm. And the other senior partner was Ralph Coleman, who represented Bill Paley and CBS. And by luck, a division of CBS was Columbia Records. And a former member of the firm had become the chief lawyer for Columbia Records. And here I was, literally 3 to 4 years out of law school, knowing that I couldn't get clients to be anywhere commensurate with the clients of CBS or Paley. They were not interested in my business. They were interested in me serving them. And so he made an offer. He, namely my predecessor, man named Toby Shines, asked, who's doing non-litigation work? And I was one of two people doing associate non-litigation work. And I got this offer out of the blue. Fantastic coincidence. Where within a year I would become what they call general counsel to Columbia Records. And you know, I didn't follow that advice. It's good to the advice of the senior partner, because he had seen me come to work every day with the uniform of those Ivy League graduates or law school, Harvard Law School graduates, khaki pants, and perhaps a tweed jacket, you know. He said, you wouldn't fit in to the record business. They wear gold chains there. They had zoot suits, and their fingers snapped. I've always remembered that, because a lot of the appearances that I do is to change the public perception of those of us who have really been at the front level. Because if I mention names, I really think that the record executive, based upon different incidents throughout the years, it's not defensive to say that my peers over the years stack up, I believe, greater than film, greater than any other, certainly, branch of the entertainment business. If I say David Geffen, if I say Herb Morsinger, Herb Alpert and Jerry Morris, if I say Richard Branson, you know,
Amateur again.
If I say Chris Blackwell, if I say Amateur again, or Mo Austin or Joe Smith, I could go on and on. It's not any one person. It's an incredible talent that these executives have had in music and have given back, you know, to charitable, to the hospitals and scholarships. And I mentioned this not to go either diffuse it or divert it, but obscure it. The point is that I'm very proud of all of these people in music, and the public perception of that is really off greatly because of maybe the excesses of a few, of a handful. And anyway, so I plunged in the record business. I learned that you can't practice law in the abstract. You can't be an ivory tower lawyer. To me, if you're a lawyer for anybody, and certainly if you're a house lawyer, you've got to learn the understanding business. You can't loftily just give abstract advice. And in doing that, so if I did a Broadway show contract, because we had My Fair Lady and Camelot and West Side Story, and then more with me, Cabaret in Chicago. I would only be invited to the opening night, and Garvin saw that. And so that no one before that, coming from the law, you know, living a different life. But I plunged in, I had to learn everything about the underlying record business and went to sales conventions to learn the underlying business of music that I fell in love with. And so what Anthony is saying, again, the role of what? And that is, we come to 5 years hence, I'm a lawyer for 5 years, and God, who didn't know, and I didn't know whether I had any ears or had any penchant for music, but he certainly knew that I loved the music business. And yet, when it came to him becoming the group president, he called me into his office, because again, let me break your shibboleth, which is certainly not true. I've seen so many big companies, and as you read the business section of the Wall Street Journal or the New York Times, the word synergy, let's buy everything that's synergistic. And so in the era of the conglomerate, you found that we at CBS and Columbia Records bought Leslie speakers and Steinway pianos and Fender guitars. I knew nothing about any of them, but I was the lawyer making those deals. So Goddard came to me and he said, I would like to offer you, I'm becoming a group president, and I would like to offer you the presidency of the musical instrument group. So he was going to get a very nice economic raise, so that was beneficial, but I knew the Fender was in Santa Ana, and that I had two children from my first marriage who were living with me, and that if I moved more than 50 miles out of New York, I would lose the custody that I had of my two oldest children. And so I said, let me go back and think about it. This is clearly a major, and I'm grateful for this offer, but I got to think about it. And I went back overnight, and I came to the conclusion that I could not put myself in the position of perhaps losing custody of my children. And so I was coming in prepared to turn down when I get a call on the entrance to my office, and God said, I want you to come in, I'd like to speak with you. And I came in there and he said, look, we have an executive vice president, Norman Adler. Norman really wants to live in La Jolla, really wants to live on the West Coast, and he would love the combination of the musical instruments division and creative playthings at the time. And he said, so he would love that. Pause. So you'll be the head of Columbia Records.
Ah, it's great to
have it. Sure, you know, I got that job.
Such a fantastic moment. I mean, when you think about everything that has evolved out of that moment, beginning perhaps most significantly with your journey out to the Monterey Pop Festival, which in 1967, obviously, you know, a festival that preceded Woodstock by a couple of years, and was, you know, turned out to be a kind of seminal moment. A brilliant movie has been made about it. But, you know, Clive was invited to go by a colleague and, you know, kind of drifted out there for a weekend in California and, you know, wore his tennis sweater and saw something that maybe didn't expect to see.
You know, that is true. I mean, I got to be head of the company, and if you're wise, you don't get impressed with your title. You get, you know, sort of challenged by the opportunity. So here I saw a company steeped in classical music. The New York Philharmonic, the Cleveland Orchestra with George Zell, Philharmonic with Bernstein, the Philadelphia with all the things, Vladimir Harper, Isaac Stern, Glenn Gould. And so I immediately went Carnegie Hall, Lincoln said that to learn is much. I'm a great believer in the work ethic. I so value the education I had in the public school system of Brooklyn, PS 161, Erasmus Hall. I so benefited from that work ethic, that need to study hard in order to improve your station. And Broadway shows, they were premiering, and middle-of-the-road music, St. Walter Mitch. They just signed Barbra Streisand, and they had Andy Williams. But in the rock field, other than Bob Dylan, and, you know, Top 40 group Paul Revere and the Raiders, the Birds, they were not really in rock and roll. They were not premier anywhere near that, in that area. And so the first thing I observed is those A&R men, those creative people, A for artist or for repertoire, those men and women who find the artists or select repertoire for entertainers who don't write, if they're doing Tony Bennett, if they're doing Johnny Mathis or Andy Williams, they're not going to be aware of what is going on. It's a different field. And they built up because it was successful. And I knew the business was changing. I knew, despite what I've said, the company with the pre-tax profit when I got in there was $3 million. So it was 3% return on $100 million of volume. And it was precarious because the field was changing. I didn't have to change it. But I knew that the existing staff, as talented as they were specialized in areas that were not growth area. And so I come to the Monterey Pop Festival, shocked beyond belief at what everyone else was wearing. I was the one that was standing out in my khaki pants and my tennis shoes. And everyone else was in robes and long dresses and long hair. But it was a tremendous cultural revolution. Because that was coupled with the philosophy of love, peace, and flowers in a beautiful prime state. And apart from the social and cultural revolution that I experienced, was it a musical revolution? That here I, to this day, I don't read music, but I was overwhelmed by the amplification of the guitar. I was overwhelmed by one artist after another, groups like the Electric Flag, a great drummer, Buddy Miles, and a guitarist, Mike Bloomfield, the individual songwriting talent of Laura Nero. And then, of course, taking the stage, I had never heard of it, was this group called Big Brother and the Holding Company. And the lead singer was this vibrating, compelling, exhilarating, white soul sister named Janis Joplin. I had never seen her anything like that. And that did indeed change my life. I knew through every fiber of my being that I had to sign this artist, that I would not, no one else from my company was there. It was going to be a social weekend enjoying Saturday Golf Uncle and Mamas and Papas. And never thought, but coming out of that and learning from seeing Hendrix and the Who and all the great artists, this was a revolution. And I was fortunate that I was one of the very few executives there. And so I quietly signed Big Brother and the Holding Company, buying her contract, because she was under contract to a small company called Mainstream Records. No records were out. And then I come back to Greenwich Village a few weeks later, and who does audition for me? But I had seen the horn group there. I had seen the makings of the fusion of jazz with rock and pop music, and I see Blood, Sweat, and Tears. And in very short order, I trusted my ears and signed Big Brother. I signed Laura Nero from that, even though she was not distinguished at that festival. She later auditioned and played the songs that made her so special as a songwriter. And I was, within the first 3 years, to sign Chicago, to sign Santana, whom I signed twice, but the first time was in 1969. So that only from the track record that was being built and the success of each of these artists and my heralding it as a revolution that would be heard around the world, did it give me the confidence to know that I had an undiscovered gift of a natural ear for music, and that I was able to discern, you know, the finding of this talent that would, in many cases, the talent would be around, not just for hit record or one day wonder, but for decades.
You know, obviously there's a tremendous track record of success at Columbia. And, you know, as you entered the 70s, obviously the music industry is beginning to grow, and you actually, among your A&R men, had a great one named John Hammond, and he brought an artist into you, had a tape and wanted you to hear some songs, and it was somebody that you grew interested in signing, and also somebody that you gave some significant advice about performance to. I wonder if you could, you know, fill us in on that artist.
What Anthony is alluding to, of course, was Bruce Springsteen. And you saw him on that tape, in that trailer. There are many lessons from that. When Bruce sang for me, it was very clear when I explored his lyrics is that he was very different from Bob Dylan. And his imagery, everything that he was writing about, was, you know, unique and special. So with John Hammond, I agreed and we signed Springsteen. The few factors that I'll extract from my experience, and as I've written about, was that number one, when he turned in Greetings from Asbury Park, I did, and on that same tape he goes on to say, you know, I did turn it back to him, and I said, you know, there were no really radio-friendly songs since on the album. We're going to need ammunition. We're going to need radio to help break you commercially. And instead of being defensive, so often, there are so many times, what is the role of a helpful executive? How can a company really make a difference? How can you, as an executive, make a difference without threatening the creative sphere, that the integrity that must be preserved for an artist? And if you do it reasonably, it's not threatening. But if you do it wrongfully, of course it is threatening. And he took it as the brilliant guy that he is, and he said, you know, you're probably right. And as he goes on to say, he went up writing the great song, Blinded by the Light and Spirit in the Night. And then we go forward. I'm no longer with Columbia. I founded a new company, Arista. He still is not broken. But he asked me to come see him at the Bottom Line. And I remember, you know, in 1973, when Bill Graham closed all the Fillmores, and the press, as usual, was writing Walking Dead, and they're only foreseeing the demise of contemporary music. To make a point, I took over this Amundsen Theater, a huge theater, the size, stage size of Radio City. And I wanted to show with Bruce Springsteen, with Miles Davis, with Johnny Mathis, with a variety of pop and rock and rhythm and blues artists, that music was vital. But when Springsteen came to rehearsal, He stood in the center stage and did not move. And when you saw the vast stage, and he was just playing acoustically, I said to myself, you know, this is, I got up on stage from where you're sitting, and I came up there and I said, Bruce, you know, this is not Max in Kansas City, it's not CBGB's. I said, you've really got to walk from one side, I'm walking from one side of the stage to the other side of the stage. And said, when you get a stage this size, make use of it. Fast forward, the bottom line, I take Lou Reed down and go to see Bruce Springsteen, who was not broken. And the show begins. And that's a revelation that you can't teach to a genius, you can't teach to a natural. He was mesmerized. He was, had become, on his own, the Bruce Springsteen we all know is the greatest live performer to come out any American artist or group. And he jumped on tables, you know, around the bottom line. Just when everywhere met the light, my jaw dropped. And so to show him that I go backstage, it's a small dressing room, and I walk in. And he looks up at me and he says, so Clive, did I move around enough?
Now, just at a moment, you know, in 1973, where it just seemed as if, you know, things could hardly get better at Columbia, you know, you're just completely on a roll. One day, you walk into your office and you're fired. I mean, this is, I mean, a lesson in terms of any career, maybe, where you know it's never just kind of direct line up, and obviously it was a shocking thing. There were, you know, all kinds of allegations about drugs and, you know, things that people are always talking about the music industry for. You know, can you talk a bit about your emotions during that time, your feelings during that time, and you know, what you determined that you needed to do to get through that situation?
Well, this is in furtherance of, I think, what the trailer said, is that no one's life goes up, up, up. And you get challenged. This was the toughest challenge that I ever had in my life. Someone that worked for me, and unbeknownst to me, not only stolen money, but fraudulently endorsed invoices in a scurrilous manner that would put him in jail. I had to fire him. And when it came time for him to realize that he was facing a jail term, he did meet with the U.S. attorney in New Jersey and said that he would cooperate to obviously lessen his sentence, lessen his punishment. And he really promised, I think, that they would find a rampant payola and drug ola in the record industry. And so all terror broke loose. At CBS was a government licensed business. They had to separate themselves from Columbia Records at all costs. Their law firm, Crevasse Wayne Moore, advised separate yourself. And so yes, I, even though on the same issues that had occurred, had been re-elected to the board of CBS, was shockingly dismissed. And because of the ongoing investigation, the severity of it, the magnitude of it that affected the entire industry, I had to stay uncharacteristically quiet. I was not able to issue any statement. So it was a painful period. I had to wait for the investigation to be over. I had to wait for the total exoneration of Columbia Records, that there was no payola, there was no drug over there. It was a witch hunt. millions of dollars were spent in this investigation. And I really had to endure a very painful period, never thinking for a minute that I would ever leave music. I mean, by that time, I had gotten them into R&B music. I had made my first label deal with Philadelphia International Records. So apart from the rock that got me subsequently in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, apart from pop that I dealt with Andrew Williams or Tony Bennett, and progressive music with Miles Davis, Weather Report, Miles Visual Orchestra, you know, I knew that I was doing it without a checkbook. I was doing it because I was there, and that if need be, I'd start a new company, because it was not that, you know. The industry, they were on the fence. Is this a lawyer that had the imprimatur of Columbia Records? Could he do it from scratch? But I started a new company with the backing of Columbia Pictures, named it Arista, after the high schools in New York, if you got 90% average or more, they were called Arista. And led to, you know, two Sigma events. One, 2 years after I formed Arista, and in the index of my book is a picture of a check from Columbia Records, from CBS, for the mail order rates for anything my new company would come for. But it was for $1 million of a company that I was a partner in. You know, in a way of saying, you know, you stood up for us. And indeed, a year later, I got the Martel Foundation Award, and Bruce Lundvall, the president of Columbia Records, said, in this witch hunt period, nobody could have represented the company, the industry, as you did, and come off in the manner of which you did. So I'm saying it, because life isn't up, up, and up. And the book is very clear, you know, that you do have to go through. You stay around long enough, you know, you're going to have certain challenges. This was a profound one, a traumatic one, but I was able to overcome it. Very happy, of course, that I never once questioned whether music was the career for me.
Well, you know, that certainly proved to be the case. But obviously, when you founded Arista, you know, which initially you took over a company called Bell Records, and you were allowed to keep whatever artists on that label. You obviously sifted through
them. I'll just interrupt you, because this does keep coming up. I never took over Bell. This was an arrangement I made with Columbia Pictures to start a brand new company. They had a previous record company that had a number of successes, but they were not making it economically. And I had the right to consult Bell Records and to extract from Bell Records to this new company that I was forming whatever assets, whatever artists that they had that I felt had a future. So I never had a title within Bell Records, and I'm just for the record saying that I never took over Bell. I started Arista and went through their artist roster and signed from that artist roster, seeing a brand new, unknown, relatively unknown artist named Barry Manilow. Melissa Manchester. I was able to get from them the catalog of Tony Emmanuel, Dawn in the Fifth Dimension, and the Broadway show Godspell. So we didn't start from scratch, and we did have some momentum beginning the company.
Well, certainly with Barry Manilow, one of the issues that came up was, you know, for all the tremendous success that you had with him, you know, there was a kind of a difference maybe in how you, each of you conceived of his career. On the one hand, you know, you understood that he wrote songs, but you know, you saw him primarily as a performer and as a singer, as an arranger. You know, he very much saw himself as a singer-songwriter, and you know, you were having hits, but in a certain sense, you know, that was difficult for him because many of those hits came from songs that he selected for him when he wanted to be writing his own songs. I wonder if you could tell us about you know, some of the conversations you had, maybe, you know, about, like, I write the songs, for example, or other conversations.
Not a conversation,
though. Well,
before Marister, I listened to Barry's album that he was doing. I said, Barry, it's a real good album. You need a hit single. And I don't think there is a hit single in that album. And I said, just give me a few weeks, because I decided what I never did at Columbia, but what I would do now with a new company, Arista, the R&R repertoire, I would look for material to hasten our market share growth for artists who didn't write, or if they did write, did not write enough hits to propel a major pop career. And so I came up with a song that we renamed Mandy. And I went over with Barry, who's a fabulous arranger, what the arrangement should be. I heard it in my head as the ballad that he brilliantly arranged it to become. And of course, that was the first record Arista released. It went straight to number one. We made our mark right from the beginning. And based on that, Barry Manilow gave me two songs in every future album of his. And again, it was signaling a new part of my career. So then when you see that I work with O'Fallon material for Dina Warwick or Aretha Franklin, or ultimately for Whitney Houston, it all began making every song in Modesty Says He, but factually accurate, every song hit. So when I was trying to get the feeling again, Weekend in New England, I write the song, Can't Smile Without You, Looks Like We Made It, I Made It Through the Rain, etc. Every song became a hit. Now Barry was writing This One's For You, he was writing Copacabana, he was writing Daybreak, Could It Be Magic. So he did, but he had three albums a year. And he knew, and I knew, that he needed this, all these supplemental hits, most of which became the signature song that keep him headlining to this very day. And the point that Anthony is, as a scene I write in the book, where after maybe 8 or 9 years, we get together for still another album, and I come in with my two songs, and there was clearly growing tension between them. He was very appreciative. He certainly knew that economically he benefited incredibly, but he just resisted the concept. And I said, you know, it's time that you talk about it. And I said, I sense this tension, this resistance. Is it accurate? And he said, it is accurate. And he said, the reason you have changed my dream was to be solely a composer, creative writer, arranger. That's what I do, that's what I love. And you've turned me into another Andy Williams. You've turned me into a Perry Como. That's not what I mean. And so now, you've got to remember, we had otherwise gotten along great, but we're two Jews from Brooklyn fighting each other. And I looked at him and I said, Barry, if you were Irving Berlin, we'd know it by now. We've gotten over that. He did separate for a year. He came back knowing what he was resisting was an unbelievable asset. So I say in the spirit of accuracy plus the enormity of it, it's that birthday, yeah, big celebration in Palm Springs. Of course, Barry came. We are still very close friends to this day. And we've had the unique pleasure that both of our dreams have come through. He was inducted, and I had a big party for him in my home weekend home in Cambridge to celebrate his induction into the Songwriters Hall of Fame. And then the very next year, there's an award called the Ella Award that is given to Sinatra or Streisand or Tony Bennett or Johnny Mathis. And they asked me to present it to him in my vision for him as really a spectacular entertainer and interpreter of song. So we both really treasure our relationship and his career.
Well, now, obviously, you know, we've got a lot of ground to cover here, but I'm probably, you know, the artist with whom you're most associated is Whitney Houston. You know, Whitney, whom you discovered, you know, the first two albums each sold, you know, more than 20 million copies. You selected producers, you selected the songs, you worked very closely with her. Of course, moving on up through The Bodyguard, you know, another gigantic hit, you know, I Will Always Love You, and, you know, the level of success. And, but as we all know, there was the downward spiral that her life took. And I wonder, and ultimately, you know, her death occurring on the day of, you know, your famous, you know, pre-Grammy party in Los Angeles, in the very hotel where the party is going to take place. You know, I mean, I wonder if you could just describe your feelings that day and you know, what you felt about it and you know, how you got through it and what you feel, you know, Whitney's legacy is.
Well, of course, the day was unimaginably painful. I mean, this Grammy party, I had started really the year that we had a hit with Mandy. And we were a small little company, Arista Records, just starting. And Barry was nominated for two Grammys. And I said, you know, at that point, labels, as they do to this day, after the Grammys, they have their Grammy party, the day of, the night of. And I said, you know, if we would do that, the way I just come from being president of Columbia, you know, we'd have two tables in a restaurant, and that would be it. I said, so I think I'm going to do something the night before, both to welcome Arista as a new label, but to celebrate your Grammy nominations. And so it proved to be a tremendous success. Elton John came, Stevie Wonder came, John Denver came, excuse me. And I knew we were on the right track, that we, and to this day, that night belongs to me in music. And to this day, the night before the Grammy, I throw a party, the heads of every other record company to come. The only time, other than maybe an award show, where you see them all in the same room, but they lay down their armor, and I'm very honored that they come to a party that I host. And each year, I think, Alicia, when I signed Alicia Keys, what's your dream? My dream is to sing on the same stage as Aretha Franklin. That's there, and then we did that. And then, you know, Rod Stewart, when we did the Great American Songbook later, and I said, who would you like to have do a song on stage? And he would say, I'd love to do something with Lou Reed. And so we have incredible footage. And that's why I think there's so much interest in whether we have a feature film or a book, because no one has ever seen the uniqueness of the parties. It's not just a schmooze thing, the way Vanity Fair is, as great as it is. It's a show. So this year, for the younger people in the audience, apart from tributing John Fogerty or having one or two established artists and Foo Fighters on, I did have Miley Cyrus, I did have Lord, I did have Macklemore and Lewis. And, you know, it's a very special party that every nominee comes to, the heads of all the networks, motion picture studios, major athletes. I mean, it was part of Whitney used to be in that. She was 18 when I signed her. She came to every Grammy party, whether she performed spectacularly or whether she just listened. She loved, people didn't know how much she loved music. That was her life. She knew every record on the radio. And so just that very week, 48 hours before, she and I had spent several hours in my bungalow, my showing of the material I was gathering for Jennifer Hudson at the time for her album. She was playing one or two of the songs she was doing for the movie Sparkle. And she and I had clashed on the subject initially of drugs, and I write about it, and the book contains my letters to her on the subject. Not that, that I didn't understand my responsibility. But you learn that in the face of addiction, you're powerless. And as much as I argued that you had faith in me, every song, every career decision has been textbook. But when it comes to this, until an artist wants to do it herself or himself, the advice falls on deaf ears. She wasn't ready. Subsequent to the Oprah interview, where we all found out that she did go clean for quite a while, I thought the only problem was cigarette smoking. And so I was saying, and she always admitted, I quit drugs, I cannot quit heavy cigarette smoking. I cut back, I said, you gotta cut it out. Your range was so spectacular, so incredible, effortless. And so that was, after the I Look To You album, her last studio album, I said, I'm not recording you anymore unless you quit cigarette smoking. And she had told me that day, she was cutting it out totally. She, her doctor told her, you know, that she would be ready by August, and we were making plans to begin recording again in August. This was obviously February, 48 hours before she lost her life, tragically, prematurely. So, you know, that's always a painful empty space right now. I mean, made more painful for me because I'm currently working on the Whitney live album and seeing performances that I never saw. I didn't go with her to South Africa. I didn't go with her, you know, to Europe, to saw occasional Wembley in London. But now that I'm pouring over the tapes of her live performance and seeing the magnitude. In fact, this year's Grammy, I ended the party at 12:30 in the morning when most people in LA would clearly have left to show that 14-minute performance of hers on the American Music Awards, where she sang, I love you, Porgy, going into when I tell you I'm not going from Dream Girl 6 years before the movie, and ending with I Have Nothing, everybody in the audience, you know, just in awe of somebody hitting those notes as effortlessly as she did. As I said, you know, leaving always Aretha to her side as our national treasure, the greatest singer of contemporary music, without question, was Whitney Houston.
You know, Clive, you know, you had seven straight number one hits with Whitney, you know, known as the man with the golden ears. I mean, I wonder if you could describe that process of selecting songs, identifying hit songs, you know, hearing something and knowing what it could become, even if all the aspects are not necessarily there.
Okay, so I'm going to share things, two things with you tonight, a little different way. One is, to make the point, which is not too trade-oriented, the importance of song. You can have the best voice in the world, but if you're not given the best material, if you don't write, as most pop R&B singers don't write their own material, true today, that Rihanna and Beyonce, there might be occasional collaboration, but they're not writers per se. They have to value who they go after for material. So one thing which is timely, because I've just signed, I'm happy to say, as the trailer pointed out, a young 18-year-old male singer whose voice is extraordinary, and we've just begun the task of looking for the best material now to launch his career. And how will we do it? Next Tuesday, I'm invited 20, 30 great songwriters to share in the power of his interpretive ability and hopefully attract, the way we did with Whitney, the best material to lead to the record. So because he lives in New Haven, he's here with us tonight, so I really want you to say hello to young Avery Wilson. Very much still beating in my heart. I still get great pleasure from it. And, you know, Avery and I knew from the moment we met, and Dad was sitting next to him and was there in at that meeting with Sean Garrett, a well-known songwriter, producer, that we have to get the best music, and that we have to, for his career, find that material that would be his signature song. So in doing that, after Barry Manilow, I started having songs more in numbers than he would let me use.
I had two for an album,
that was it, and that was working, and no more was going to happen. So it was at that point that I signed Dionne Warwick. I knew that I couldn't sign another male, but I had so many songs that were candidates, but it would be 3 years, 4 years, 5 years before I could get Barry recorded. So indeed, Barry understood. Barry indeed produced when I found I'll Never Love This Way Again, Deja Vu. He produced the I'll Never Love This Way Again cut, and we had his career. So segue, after getting two Grammys, hit record, showing how long a career could last, Dionne was back on top after the first background years, and I was, where will I get more songs from? So I'm going to tell you and have fun with you to show you what it is to get the best demo. I just hope, Avery, we get a demo like this for us, you know, that I ever received in my career. And I, after my parents passed away, I became very close to my mother's sister who lived in Fort Lauderdale, Florida. I would visit her 3, 4, 5 times a year. So Barry Gibb of the Bee Gees learned that I was coming into the Miami-Fort Lauderdale area several times a year. What I had done for Barry, what I did with Melissa, and what we were building up became known to him. And he sent word to his manager, would I have lunch with him in Miami at his hometown? You certainly know the Bee Gees are one of the great groups of all time. It was just following the time that he had produced Guilty for Barbra Streisand, number one record, Grammy Award winning. So you're talking about an artist, a songwriter, a producer at the height of his fame. And we had this lovely lunch at his home in Miami. And he said, look, you must know that I must have a record. I really would love to do a record with you. And I think we'd have great fun with it. And what artist on your label do you think would be the right collaborator association with me Of course, I took out of my pocket the artist roster, hoping that he would bring that sucker down. I had an alphabet copy. And you see why I had to anxiously wait as he went over this artist roster and went down and flipped the page and went down and flipped the page. And then he got to W and D.L. Moore. And he said, D.L. Moore is one of my idols. I will write you a song for D.L. Moore. I couldn't believe it. I'm telling you the truth. I mean, it was amazing to me because often when you're an artist, it's hard for an artist to give away a good song if that artist could do that song himself or herself. He told me I would get that song within 10 days, within that time period. I got this demo that I'm going to play for you. I could not believe it. What this demo sounded like. It was a hit song. It would have been number one for the Bee Gees. It would have been number one for Barry Gibb. And of course, it ended up being number one for Dionne Warwick. Perhaps you'll remember. Let's play that if you can. It's a good lesson for everybody. And they recorded, and this was the result. Let's play it. hour, I'm going to telescope the next point, but I'm going to give you a taste of it because I think we could have a little fun with it. And that is, I love the fact of extending artists' careers. It's been terrific with the artists that I've discovered from the beginning that you've seen, and it's incredibly pleasurable, thrilling, gratifying to do that. But it's also equally as satisfying extending careers. So you know that I signed Carlos Santana in 1969. We had great success with Oya Kamabai, with Black Magic Woman and Evil Ways, and he's gone on, of course, to be the Guitar God. And yet he got very ethereal in the years when we were no longer working. And he got very spiritual, he got very progressive. John Coltrane, you know, Miles Davis were big influences on him. And he got to the point where he no longer had radio hits. And through his spirituality, it led him to me. And
I mean, that's an actual fact. That's
a great story.
It's a great story. When I'm saying spirituality, it led him to me. He went to his counselor. How would he reconnect the molecules to my friend's kids? You know, it's a big story. It's in my book. And it did lead them to me. Because they said, you had teenage kids, what do you want? And he says, I want to be on the radio. And I want my kids to hear me on the radio. And we ended up doing the incredible Supernatural album together. He gave me half of it. He took the other half in his inimitable style. And the combination has made it now among the top 12 best-selling albums worldwide of all time. And Smooth came from my heart. Maria came from that. And so that album, you know, which was called Davis's Folly, citing a 58-year-old man who had not had a hit in 25 years, to have his album do what it did. How do you follow it? So this song came to me, and I said, my God, this could be a great follow-up, a great hit song. And we tried Macy Gray. We don't have the time to play all of it. And as great as Macy is, she just didn't, it didn't feel right. It just didn't feel that this was the great match. And then we gave the song to Michelle Branch. I'll play a minute of it. If you could play the, maybe the eighth song there, the Michelle Branch version of this song, which was to become a huge hit record, win Grammys. Being done by Michelle Branch. And it came out incredibly well. And I was so excited that I immediately called her manager and I said, oh my God, they're going to release this as the single. Which of course means we're going to have to do a video and I'll just ask for a limited number of network TV shows. And the answer was this artist would not do the video. Really just was doing a nice album cut was her thought for the Santana album. Well, without getting the commitment to do a video, without getting the commitment to do some TV shows, we were not able to release this version. So you're going to hear tonight, and I would like, if you could, just to raise the light so that when any of you feel that you know who this artist is, you can stand up. But be honest about it, because you're not interrogating you. And I'm not saying you're right either. But let's play this version that really, for the reasons mentioned, never has been released, but gives you some insight to the full panoply of record industry dilemmas. Play it loud, please. Listen to the great Miss Tina Turner.
in case anybody hasn't realized it to this point, if you're on Clive Davis time, you know, where Clive is out every night, so he's up later, listens to his music louder than that's nothing. You have to listen in his office sometime. But what we'd love right now is if any of you have any questions for Clive, I'm sure he'd be happy to take some from you. Or comments, remarks of one sort or another.
Why do you, if she was living in Switzerland, she really has retired, and only out of respect for Carlos did she agree to do the song as an album cut. She was not prepared to re-enter the music business and to either do a video or network appearances. So it was not anything vindictive by any means or her not liking the performance. It really, you know, has been, for this inimitable old-timer, a lifestyle decision. And that was very consistent with her lifestyle.
I think you were next.
First of all, I want to thank you so much for being with us here tonight. And you're unbelievable. I have two short questions. Firstly, what was your favorite era of music from the 60s?
Favorite era of music?
Era.
Yeah, time.
In the industry and
before. The favorite one was the revolutionary period of the late 60s, early 70s, when my career began, and, you know, whether it's Big Brother or whether it's Springsteen or whether it's Blood, Sweat & Tears, Chicago, Santana, Earth, Wind & Fire. I mean, it was dazzling. In its introduction of all-time pioneering, trend-setting, cutting-edge artists. So that is not to be duplicated anymore, I might say. The golden era of Broadway, you know, I can mention there are a lot of hits right now, so we're going to, you know, but that era that provided the vintage musical, whether it was Sound of Music or Sound of Pacific, where every song that you heard became a great American songbook. It's for that reason, I should say, that next year I'll be bringing my Fair Lady to Broadway. I'm happy. It's only got one revival with Richard Chamberlain. It was not given that when you realize Chet Rex Harris and Julie Andrews and the movie with Audrey Hepburn and the songs that came out of it, not to disparage some really good musicals that are coming, but they've not come out. You don't come off humming every song in the show. I just want the world again to hear On the Street Where You Live, and I've grown accustomed to your face, and all the great songs that came out of My Fair Lady. So what I'm saying is, Broadway had a vintage era. They also had a drama era with Tennessee Williams and Eugene O'Neill. You know, the movies with All About Eve. It's not a golden creative period right now, and that's the reason why I'm going back to that revolutionary period in the late 60s, 70s, you know, obviously that have become so revolutionary in music.
I think
we've got to limit you to one.
A while back, I got a call from UCLA. They had a real problem. A lot of students there that wanted to get into the music industry. The problem was, there wasn't a single person on the faculty that had ever been in the music industry. All they knew was classical and maybe a little tiny bit of jazz, and that was it. And they couldn't teach people what they really wanted to know. This is still true at most colleges and most universities. That was one reason why I was so gratified that the Clive Davis School was opened to actually teach people about the industry. And, and some of you have mentioned, And incidentally, I like to teach them.
I'm consistent with what I said at the beginning, where education is so valuable to me, and that I never would have had a career in anything if I didn't go by scholarship to the scholarships that I enjoyed every year at NYU. I never got it. The Harvard Law School never would come through. So being in a position to give back, I have endowed at Tisch of NYU, the Clive Davis Institute of Contemporary Music. And it is now the most applied to division within NYU, I'm happy to say. Awarding a BFA program, and the students love it, and so many of my colleagues have participated. Alicia's husband's speech was a professor, resident professor 2 years ago. Alicia's gone down there, Stevie Wonder's gone down there. It's just an incredible school, and the students just love it.
Hi, Clive, from one Brooklynite to another. Thank you so much for your amazing contribution and the wonderful music you brought us. I do have a question. You just showed us how Tina Turner passed up an amazing opportunity. Can you share with us a time that you passed up on a wonderful artist or a great song?
Could you talk about like a great artist or a great song that you passed on?
Okay. I have a story that was just updated. I passed on two major artists. One was Meatloaf. James Diamond did play. Presumably they were the songs of the Bat Out of Hell. It was very different. It was very theatrical. I thought James Diamond was great. I later worked with Jim, found hits on Making Love Out of Nothing at All for Air Supply, big hit for Barry Manilow, but it seemed unlikely. So every one of us, me included, did pass on Meatloaf. The other artist that I cited who had a longer term career rather than one huge or two huge albums, but a lengthy career, with John Mellencamp, John Cougar. And I was just at a dinner within the last about four or five years ago. And it was the night before the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. And being inducted that year was Jan Wenner of Rolling Stone. Now I'm not saying this defensively, I'm just bringing this up today. Who was there? So anyway, cocktails were over, we sat down, and it's like one of those games where you sit down at a table, and on my left is Bruce Springsteen, on his left is John Mellencamp, on his left is Jackson Browne, and on his left is Don Henley. And we get to talking, and by coincidence, I had really auditioned everybody but Don Henley. Now, I thought I auditioned Jackson Browne. He said, I was in your office, but the audition never took place. We postponed it, and David, my manager, Geffen, said, I'm going to sign you, so I never did audition for him. Ridiculous. Springsteen you know about. And I said, John, I want you to know that in every interview, the most long-lasting, the most successful, the most original artist that I ever passed on was you. And I said, I got to tell you, for whatever the reason, my memory is vivid. Now this story is a just word for word accurate, and I said, not being embellished ever, and I said, you were so close to the gentleman on my left, Bruce Springsteen, and here I was in on the signing of Bruce, And I really thought that you were somewhat imitative of Bruce. And maybe I was too close to the situation because without question, you found your own voice. You are a great original American rock and roller. At the audition for me, I didn't hear that. And he said to me something fascinating, which made me feel great, by the way. He said, you should rest easy. 8 weeks before I auditioned for you, I was in a cover band. A cover band is like a Las Vegas group that plays the hits of other writers, doesn't write any original material. It's called the cover band. They cover the hits. No originality, but they can be very appealing. Many of you have gotten married in weddings with you. And he said, there's a guy coming into my performance smoking a cigar, turns out to be a man named Tony DeFries, who was the manager of David Bowie. And he came to me and he said, you should be a solo artist. You've got to get out of this group. You've got to stop recording cover material. And you've got to really see what comes out of your pen. Because in rock, you want artists to record their own material. And understanding what I said of songs I found for Whitney, Aretha, Dion, Barry. I mean, when I signed rock artists, it's for their genius. I would never give a song. We haven't talked about the Patti Smith, the Grateful Dead, you know, or Alicia Keys, the way I was able to sign. I would never give a song to a Renaissance young woman like Alicia Keys, who with a gifted pen writes the amazing songs that she does. So he said, I quit the band, I started writing, and within 8 weeks, he calls me up and he says, I'm going to audition for you. So he says, let me tell you, the biggest influence that I had in that 8 week period that was my hero was Bruce Springsteen, and you were 100% right. I was very much in the shadow and owe all those songs to Bruce Springsteen. I was not earning my chops as a songwriter the way that I was emerging later. So now you got the whole story. We'll really take three more if they could. Because I promised to sign some books.
Do you have any major regrets about your career, and if not, were there any major disappointments?
Well, yes, of course you regret. I mean, I certainly regret, even though I was subsequently vindicated, being fired, the wound of that never leaves. Did I emerge stronger? Yes. Did I emerge, you know, with my own company? Did I end up making far more money from equity interest than I would have made if I stayed a salaried employee of a large corporation? Yes. But you regret. You remember pain. I remember the pain. I was so innocent, I never knew that Janis Joplin might have been doing life-threatening drugs. She was just willing to be a drinker, living tit for today and not tomorrow. What a tragic. I most regret, of course, you know, having had the intense friendship and personal relationship, apart from professional with Whitney, that I was unable to make a difference the way I would have wanted as her industry father. So that pain lived with you, and the loss lived with you. But what over, you know, a personal level is overwhelming is the luck, is the good fortune that led me to a career where I love what I do, where music is a passion, where it drives me, and I love it to this day, recommend it for those that do so. And with the same kind of excitement, I look forward to next Tuesday, Avery, when we are looking for material for you.
have a question over here.
My question is whether you have any comments you could, or stories you could share with us about your relationship in Columbia with Bob Dylan?
Oh, your relationship with Bob Dylan.
There's a chapter in the book about Bob Dylan. It was always with the greatest of respect for his brilliance. You know, there's no accident that I think Time magazine at the end of the last century said who were the great, among the great 100 greatest of the 20th century. That coming from music were the Beatles, Bob Dylan, and Aretha Franklin, among maybe two or three others. His influence will be written about forever. He didn't just write songs, the answer is blowing in the wind. You know, you go through the lyrics, he changed social consciousness. His influence on Springsteen, on anybody that came after him, is legendary. And so he is an historic, old-time figure, probably matchless in some ways of anybody who's ever been in music. And I respected it. I talk a parable where I pick singles, you know, because the only contribution I could make when I picked Lay Baby Lay, and it was shot, you know, with the ambiguity of the title as to whether it gets played on the radio. He was, you know, very, very special. I learned one basic point, which I applied during the career of Patti Smith and others. When he had his accident and he was in a cast to his neck, he didn't release press releases. He waited for the public's interest to only grow as he mysteriously was absent for the scene from a year or 2 years or more. And so you learn, in many cases, less is more. So when Patti had her accident, I mentioned that to her. I said, I think we just work, you know, and use Bob Dylan's example as a lesson here. Bob Dylan is an all-time great, and I didn't discover him. I just made it nice for him.
Okay, here we go. Our last word.
I'm the founder of a startup. It's the National Singers Registry, and it's a database where talent and people looking for talent can find each other. I was wondering what advice you would give to myself and other people who have startups in the music industry today.
The advice you would give to someone you know, with a startup company in the music industry today?
Yeah. Well, at a few different levels, let me make some concluding points. Do I think a startup company can make it today? Yeah. I do feel that if you have ears and you recognize talent, and today with the advantage of the internet and social media, that you can have a successful company and can take down some of the larger companies if they're not at the hub of creativity. As far as an artist is concerned, I think they're all more, radio is still preeminent. Radio is still the main way to break an artist, but they're are many other ways. In these early years, it's led to viral hits from social media that create hit singles, but don't create hit artists. So that you find singles selling 5 million, 6 million, but it doesn't create any album sales because the artists, they're not curious to buy the album. But if that was a cut, for example, Royals with Lord, okay? That's an example of a 17-year-old girl from New England in short order being a household name, you know, and I think through an independent company.
Yeah.
I chose it to appear at my Grammy party this year because of respect for that. So, can it happen? Yes. Will it happen? Yes. Good luck to you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Sorry, I saw this.